So hi guys, today our speaker is Dr. Dario Rosa, Faculty of Science, Center for Theoretical Physics of Complex Systems, Institute for Basic Science from Korea, and he will going to speak about non-local interactions enhance the performances of quantum batteries, the case of SYK. And it is based on the three mentioned work in the first slide. And this is the 79th talk in the series. And I'm welcoming Dario for giving this talk. And thank you for agreeing to give this talk. So
thank you for inviting me. Start. Okay, thank you very much. So yeah, thank you for the introduction. And as Sayantan said, my goal today is to talk about quantum batteries and in particular how some non-local interactions can enhance the performances of quantum batteries. And in particular, I will focus on the SYK model, which as we all know is very prototypical and very interesting model of non-local interactions. So I will focus mostly on that. The paper, as Sayanta mentioned, sorry, the paper, the talk, as Sayanta mentioned, is based on three papers that appeared, let's say two of them last year, and the last one is still a preprint, but probably will appear soon. This work has been done mostly in collaboration with Matteo Carrega and Davide Rossini, Marcello Andolina, and Marco Polini. All of them are from Italy, and also with Juno Kim, who is currently a postdoc in IIS. And let me say that probably I will not have time to talk, but there is some work in progress that probably will appear soon, hopefully, in collaboration with, again, Matteo and Juno, and also with Jeff Murugan from Cape Town, and also Jan Hall from Spain, from Barcelona. So, okay, so let's start, and let's start from the very beginning. So let me try to convince you, or let's say to explain you what I mean by a quantum battery. So a quantum battery is a very simple thing. It's a quantum system. In principle, it's just a quantum system. Today, I will focus on quantum many-body system, but can be also few-body. Anyway, it is a quantum system which can be used and can behave as an energy storage device. So what do I mean by that? Well, the idea is that we have our quantum battery in the ground state, and this is, let's say, our discharged battery. Then the idea is that we pump some energy into the system, and in this way we move to what I call the charge battery, in which essentially instead of being in the ground state, I'm in an excited state. So I, let's say, store the energy in the state, in the excited state. And the idea is that I can keep this energy stored in the state for a while, and after a while, when I need, I can use this energy to perform some work and go down again to some lower state, which is again my discharge battery. So this is what I mean. And in particular, in this talk, we will consider batteries that are made by system of spins 1/2. So they are our usual spin systems. So I will denote them by Pauli operators, sigma I, X, Y, Z, where X, Y, Z are the usual Pauli indices, sigma, the usual Pauli matrices. And I is because all these batteries that we will describe today will be, let's say, arranged on a spin chain of length L. So I is an index for the lattice site in which this particular spin is placed. Okay, I told already this to our organizer, but let me mention to also attendance that it would be nice if you ask your questions during the talk, such that the talk become a bit more interactive.
I have a question, Dario. So
you have
what is the necessity of discretizing the system in terms of lattice?
Well, let's say that the main reason is that because we still want at a certain moment maybe try to build these guys, and so we have in mind some qubit systems, and so they are discrete if you want by definition. I will give you more more indication later, because we will study some scaling with the dimension of the lattice sites. So but yeah, let's say that this is because of technological purposes. Our idea is to build such a battery at a certain moment, and the usual playground to build such a battery is through some qubit system. Okay, so our initial Hamiltonian, let's say our initial battery in the ground state and discharge, is given by a very simple single particle Hamiltonian in its ground state. So our example that we will consider for most of the time is, for example, a simple H knot in which our spins, sigma, are immersed in a background constant magnetic field H, where I take conventionally H greater than zero, align along the z-axis. So our Hamiltonian is simply H times the sum of sigma I z, and of course it's super.
H is kind of an interaction strength here.
No. It's not an interaction. H is the strength of the magnetic field, which is constant.
Okay. Strength of the magnetic field. Okay.
Right. So there is no interaction. At this moment, the system is not interacting at all. Each spin has its own life, and it doesn't see any presence of the other spin. It just tend to align the spin along the z-axis because of this magnetic field. And as I said, the idea is that we start from the ground state of this very simple Hamiltonian. So it's very easy to understand that our discharge battery is simply the ground state of this guy, which is the state in which all the spins are aligned down. So minus, 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 and so on up to L. Okay, so this is our starting point, and this is the plan of the talk. So I will discuss first of all a bit about the charging protocols. So as I said, we need to charge our battery, which means we need to bring from our state, from the ground state to some excited state, and we can do it in several ways. And I will focus on what I call the double quench, which is we describe it. Then I will describe some universal features of a charging via the sudden double quench. And then I will focus, if you want, these are the three main points of the talk. I will start to describe how interactions in the quench can help in reducing the energy fluctuations and in increasing the charging power. I will define both these quantities. And in particular, we will see that SYK batteries are nice, let's say, candidates for both these problems. And then I will provide some explanation of the charging power and what I will call the quantum charging supremacy in the later part. And then we will follow with some conclusions and maybe some discussion about some work in progress that will appear very soon. Okay, so let's start with the charging protocols. So as I said, we start from a battery, which is in the ground state. Everything is non-interacting, so super boring. We need to pump energy in the system. And today I will focus on this protocol in which the energy is pumped into the battery via what I call a double quench. So the idea is that at t equal to zero, I change, how can I say, suddenly my Hamiltonian from H naught to H naught plus kappa, this quench parameter that I will describe in a moment, times this function, which is simply a function which is zero for negative time, which is zero for time greater than the charging time that I denote by tau, and it is one between zero and tau. So I turn on a quench Hamiltonian,
so
which is
this lambda. Lambda is basically the quantity which is taking care of the instantaneous change.
Correct. This lambda passes from zero to one such that you turn on suddenly your interacting Hamiltonian. And then when you reach tau, the final time, the final charging time, you switch off again the thing. And our quench Hamiltonian, H1, is what creates the charging because it is an interacting Hamiltonian. So it moves from the ground state of H0 to some excited state of H0. So the first figure of merit that we discuss today is the energy stored in the battery. So as I said, at t equal to tau, we turn off H1 and we go down again to H0. So we can ask how much energy have we stored in our battery thanks to the quench. And this is easy to quantify. It's simply the expectation value of the excite of the states that we reach after the quench, psi tau, sorry, the expectation value of H naught over this state that we reached minus the ground state energy. And of course, the time evolution is simply this guy, exp minus I H naught plus kappa, this quench parameter that essentially tell us how strong is the quench, H1 times tau, which act on the on zero. That's it. So for the moment, we focus on this figure of merit. And the idea is that we want to study the energy stored in the battery as a function of tau, which is the time at which I turn off again my charge, my quench. By the way, it should be clear. If not, I can explain you that after turning off H1, my psi will continue to evolve because now we will be in a superposition of states of H0. So it will have a non-trivial time evolution, but the evolution will be such that E tau will not change. So let's say for H t greater than tau, E tau will be a constant. It should be clear. If not, I can explain you. So let me know.
So I have a question. Using go. This state psi tau, which is the quench state, can yeah. anybody use this state for the thermalization?
What do you mean, use for the thermalization?
Because to thermalize a system, if you include some kind of quench, so pre-quench and post-quench dynamics actually very important. And people used to construct states, the post-quench states, in terms of the pre-quench states, and that actually helps you to give incorporate the instantaneous changing information in the state as well. So I'm just asking that whether this is possible here as well or not.
Well, I'm not sure that it matters because our H naught, so both the pre-quench and the post-quench dynamics, is pretty trivial. You know, our H naught is really a non-interacting thing. So probably, I mean, probably what you say will be relevant if you take some more complicated H naught. But for our purposes, H naught is really a very simple Hamiltonian. So here, what I want just to emphasize is that we go, if you want, to a superposition of eigenstates of H naught, a superposition, such that the energy stored in the battery is greater than E zero, because they start to include some excited state in the superposition. And even though after the quench, this state continue to evolve, the energy doesn't change. If you want, the reason simply because the evolution after, when I turn off H1, is controlled by H0. And so I have here E to the minus A, E to the minus I H0 T, here I to the I H0 T, but H0 in the, which is sandwiched, commutes, so I can pass the time evolution and they get one, and so the energy doesn't change. But of course, you can study.
I have asked because there is a construction by Calabresi-Cardi, similar kind of. So they used to construct states, and using that states, they used to thermalize a system. I'm asking that is the.
I see. No, our purpose is not in that direction, I would say. I mean, let's say that we just care about the energy stored in the final state, and we are happy that it doesn't change by time evolution.
Okay,
so let's now discuss some universal features of the charging. So by universal, I mean some feature of the charging, which essentially do not depend on the particular choice of H1 that I'm gonna take. And then we will focus on how we can improve these features by playing with the H1. So this is our goal for the moment. So the first question is how E tau look like as a function of tau, so as a function of the charging time. Okay, as usual, is a good idea to start with an example and then learn the lessons from the example. So let's take our H naught to be the usual one. And for reason that actually I don't remember, I decided to fix this H not to one, but to 0.6. I don't remember why I did that. And also let me fix our kappa to be one. Is not essentially, is not essential, but let me fix. No, actually it will be essential in a moment, but we will discuss. For the moment, it's just a value. And let me go to a spin chain of length 15, which is already pretty large, because a spin chain of length 15 means that your Hilbert space is, as I mentioned, like 2 to the 15, so it's pretty large and numerically it's quite demanding. And now let's take a very simple example of quenching, which I consider an Ising chain in a transverse field. So our H1 is simply an Ising chain in which a nearest neighbor spins along the x-axis interact via coupling constants, which are composed by a constant term plus some random terms extracted from a random distribution centered in zero and with, let's say, width between -1 and +1. And let's see how this figure, how this e tau look like for this particular quench. This is what I get. So what I get is that I have an initial grow. So the energy, so the idea is that I start from tau equal to zero, then I stop the charging at tau equal to 0, 0, 1, then I stop the charging at tau equal to 0, 1, and so on. And I see how the energy behaves as a function of tau. So I have an initial grow, and this is easy to expect because, I mean, by letting the quench evolve, I start to populate the excited states of H naught. So for sure, the energy stored in the battery has to increase because, I mean, I start to populate the excited state. However, after a certain amount of time, which is model dependent, I reach a plateau value, E bar, and then I start to fluctuate quite erratically, actually, around this value. And I can, let's say, estimate the strength of the fluctuation by simply, for example, taking the maximum minus the minimum and divided by the plateau value. So this is our first result. And our goal is, of course, to maximize E bar, so store as much as possible energy in our battery, and also minimize these fluctuations because we don't want our energy to fluctuate dramatically in time. It would be nice if we can reach a charging protocol in which we reach E bar and we stay there, because if you want, these fluctuations are erratic. So you cannot predict when they will happen. And so essentially bring indetermination in your system that you don't want. So these are our first goals: maximize E bar, which is, we will see, a trivial problem; minimize delta E relative, which is an highly non-trivial problem. You will decide if it is highly non-trivial or not, but definitely it's less trivial than maximize E bar. Okay, so to start with, I want to discuss a little bit. Still, I don't want to commit too much about H1, so I don't want to say anything for the moment about H1. I want to commit about the role of kappa. So the idea is that, can I improve the performance of this battery by simply playing with kappa? So by making my quench stronger and stronger, this is what I'm gonna study.
So increase the performance means you want to minimize this fluctuation, I think.
Minimize and also, if possible, increase E bar. Exactly.
Oh, okay.
Exactly. And before going to more complicated setup, I want to try to do the simplest thing, just increase kappa. So essentially for a given H1 fixed, can I improve and how much I can improve the performance just by playing with the constant in front? If you want, this is the goal. Okay. So the question that I ask essentially tell me that I have to investigate how E bar and delta E relative vary by increasing kappa and going to the strong quench limit. Okay, to this purpose, it's convenient to define this dimensionless quantity R of tau, which is simply the difference between the energy at the time tau and the ground state energy, divided by the bandwidth of H naught. By bandwidth, I mean the difference between the largest eigenvalue of H naught and the smallest eigenvalue of H naught. These are discrete fermionic systems, so they have a finite spectrum. So this concept of the bandwidth is well defined. So I define this dimensionless quantity and I see what I can get. And this is what I get. So we see that by increasing kappa, what I do is that R and also the fluctuations improve in the sense that R bar improve, start from, let's say, 0.1 and arrive up to 0.5. And also the fluctuations is not easy, but if you compute the relative fluctuations here and here, even though the figure doesn't seem to be, but it is the case, these fluctuations are relatively smaller than this. So essentially, by increasing kappa, I can improve the performance of my battery. However, let's compare kappa equal to 10 and kappa equal to 30. Essentially, nothing changes anymore. I mean, both Ibar and both the fluctuations are the same. So this is telling me that there is a kappa star, which is highly model dependent, after which by simply increasing kappa, I cannot improve anymore my performance. So I
have just one question by saying the plots. Increasing the kappa values, does it correspond to some strong coupling regime of the theory or something?
Actually correspond to something much simpler than that. Correspond to the fact that you can forget the original H naught and the evolution is completely controlled by H1.
Okay.
If you want to call it a strong coupling, in some sense, yes, but it's important to say that you are not varying the, let's say, the internal couplings of H1. You are varying just a global
parameter.
Okay. So I don't know how to call it, but
I just want to say that, like, usually when, once we do the perturbation theory, we perturb something around a parameter. So if I call it that parameter to be the kappa, we can't call it a perturbation parameter or something like that. It is in that way stronger. And I am saying from that point.
I see. No. Okay. Anyway, here we are not doing any perturbation theory. I mean, all these results are exact. I mean, are obtained by numerical exact diagonalization. Mm-hmm. Now another important, another interesting maybe results to discuss is that when you reach your kappa star, the plateau value for R is 0.5. So essentially it's telling me that the maximum amount, and I cannot increase it anymore. So essentially it's telling me that the maximum energy that I can store in the battery is exactly half of the bandwidth. And this is the universal result. I mean, no matter which H1 you take, the maximum energy that you can store on average is 0.5, so half of the bandwidth. And this is simply telling me that the evolved state almost, let's say on average, will be some symmetric superposition involving several eigenstates of H naught, but symmetric around the center of the spectrum. And this has to be expected if you want by dynamical configurations, in the sense that if you don't reach any balance, you are not in an equilibrium, let's say dynamical equilibrium situation. So it's highly expected that at a certain moment you need to reach a configuration in which more or less the superposition is symmetric around the half of the bandwidth, and this is what we see. And as I said, unfortunately, the amount of fluctuations that you can reach is still quite bad. I mean, these fluctuations are still huge. And so essentially the lesson is that the maximum amount, you cannot reduce too much the fluctuations by simply increasing kappa. So the lesson, the take home message of this slide is that by playing with kappa, you can definitely reach a universal and pretty good value of the maximum energy stored on average, which is E bar, but you cannot reach very good performances to reduce the fluctuations. For that, you need to do something smarter, and this is what we want to do now. Okay, so let's try to improve a little bit our battery.
So one more question from the plot.
Go.
Once you increase the kappa, the fluctuation starts very early. Why this is so?
Okay, good point. The point is that, let's go back here. The point is that once you reach the limit of kappa large, okay, as we said before, you can essentially forget about H naught, right? So you get an Hamiltonian, you get an evolution which is essentially minus I kappa H1 tau. And so you can reabsorb kappa in a redefinition of tau. So what you observe here is simply the trivial fact that once kappa becomes large enough, its role is just a redefinition of the time variable. So you are, let's say, shifting. Not trivial, but it's a simple effect to understand. I mean, you just redefine your time variable by kappa. So, yeah, Okay, good. So can we improve the fluctuations? So our goal now is to say, okay, what we could do universally by just playing with the kappa has been done and is not much. So can we do something better? Can we reduce the fluctuations? And this idea go back to a paper by Davide Rossini and actually Marcello and Marco Polini in 2019, I think, in which they started to think that maybe in order to reduce the fluctuations, interactions were a good idea. So essentially the experiment that they did, and I'm gonna reproduce, let's say for pedagogical reason, is to say, okay, let's add some next to nearest neighbor interaction. So they took the original quench Hamiltonian H1 and they add an interaction in, let's say prepared in this way, in which our sigma now interact also next to nearest neighbor. And okay, so they go to
Like, please. Why this nearest neighbor interaction is related to the many body localized phase?
Okay, for our purposes is not that important. Maybe I will say few words later on. The reason why it is a numerical result. I mean, it has been shown by Frank Polman and collaborators actually many years ago, that if you take an Hamiltonian like H naught plus this particular H1 with the J2 fine tuned to this particular value, your system is in a many body localized phase. Is as it is.
And I mean, this J2 value is kind of a magic number because, like, for particularly this.
No, of course. No. Okay. Sorry. If J2 is, let's say, is not 0.3, 0. Let's say 31, you are still in many body localized phase. So, I mean, is let's say that the many body localized phase is robust against perturbation of the parameters. That is true. For this particular value, we are in a many body localized phase. I will probably say something a little bit more about that in the next few slides, or probably just by talking.
Hopefully you are not feeling bored that I am asking too many questions.
No, it's nice. Actually, I ask it to ask question, okay. So actually is good. I mean, let's say that I will comment a little bit more later about this. But yeah, let's say their idea and the path that I'm following now is just to say, okay, let's add interactions. What happens?
And one more thing, maybe you will tell why the signs are opposite.
I don't know. Let's say that, I mean, Polman and collaborators studied extensively the full, let's say, phase diagram for this model.
Okay.
I don't remember if you change the sign in which phase you go. Maybe you go to an ergodic phase. Actually, I don't really remember this detail. Let's say that this is one particular example. I mean, change a little bit the message. Don't take this example too seriously, in the sense that it's not our main concern. I'm just using to show you what kind of physics you can see by adding some interactions and to give you an intuition why at a certain moment we started to think, okay, maybe SYK is a good idea. So this is what we see. So we pass from this configuration to this configuration. Now, the point that somehow have drawn our attention has been the following. By adding this, let's say, still quite a local interaction, let's say just next to nearest neighbor interaction, we saw that indeed the fluctuations at very late time were actually quite highly suppressed. However, at early time, we still were having quite huge fluctuations. Now, let me also say that the fluctuations at early time are, essentially the lessons that we learn from this experiment was that a small and rather local interaction can probably cure late time fluctuations. However, it will be more interesting to cure the early time fluctuations. The idea is because essentially you don't want to wait forever in order to reach stability. You would like to be stable in the early time such that you can stop the charging at very early time. So our purpose was to improve this situation and get a situation in which also the late, the early time fluctuations are cured. So this was the idea. And essentially the conjecture that that we had and we tried to test was the following. Is it possible that non-local, strong, and let me add, highly chaotic interaction, is it possible that they reduce the early time fluctuations? This was the question. And we said, okay, as usual, let's first compute and then think. So we did a test. We took our SYK Hamiltonian, which is well known to be highly non-local, with strong interactions and also highly chaotic. And let's try to build an SYK quantum battery and let's see what happens. So this was the purpose.
So I have one question from the previous slide when you said that like after introducing this MBL phase, we can see mm-hmm. that the fluctuations actually reduced from the previous case. So maybe it is completely not related, but is there any connection, underlying connection with random matrices and random matrix theory?
Yes.
Because
yes.
Yes. There also we yes. see the similar kind of feature. That's why I pointed this thing.
Yes, yes, there is. There is the connection, and the connection is actually that to reduce effectively the fluctuations, you need quantum chaos and you need strong quantum chaos. So if you want, you need to have a system which is not just chaotic, but highly chaotic. And when I mean highly chaotic, I mean with the very, very large values of spectral rigidity. So it's not just sufficient that your system show level repulsion. You need something more. You need a very strong level of spectral rigidity, which is one of the main features of SYK, like, for example, Jack Verbascot and his students show, but also Schenker. I mean, many people show this point. Okay, so essentially, we are going there. It's a good point. Let me first just recap a little bit what do we mean by an SYK Hamiltonian, because essentially, since we want to build an SYK quantum battery, let me tell you what is the SYK Hamiltonian. I mean, you know, but I mean, just for sake of completeness. So let's do a small SYK detour. So an SYK Hamiltonian is simply a model built out of 2L Majorana fermions. So we have double number of Majoranas with respect to the length of the spin chain. Majorana fermions in one dimension are simply operators, gamma I, such that they obey these anti-commutation relations. So using what people call Jordan-Wigner map, they can be thought as highly non-local operators defined over the original spin chain. So the Jordan-Wigner map essentially tell me that each gamma, each Majorana operator is essentially a very, let's say, highly non-local operator defined in the original spin chain. So this is, if you want, the Jordan-Wigner map is what allow me to make a coupling between spins and Majoranas. And also the SYK, so this is in general for Majorana fermions, and the SYK model is defined by a Q-body non-local Hamiltonian defined in this way, in which I couple together Q of that, Q Majoranas, via some Gaussian coupling, J, I1, IQ, which are extracted from a Gaussian distribution with mean value zero, and variance that goes like one over L to the Q minus one power. And it is well known in the literature from a few years that this model is strongly chaotic wherever Q is larger than two, and instead become integrable in the limit, not in the limit, in the case Q equal to two. So this is our SYK detour. So we said, okay, let's try to characterize our SYK battery. And let's try to characterize then the time fluctuations. So this is our charging protocol. We start again from the same H naught, our original Hamiltonian, which is completely, let's say, non-interacting. And we had, instead of H1, which was just a nearest neighbor or next to nearest neighbor interaction, I mean, we had this SYK Hamiltonian. And we asked how the energy stored in the battery behave as a function of time. And this is our result. So essentially, we see that the fluctuations are completely disappeared. We don't see any fluctuations anymore. The system is very stable. We reach our plateau energy and essentially nothing moves from there. So, I mean, we were of course satisfied because this was our goal, but of course we wanted also to understand why this was happening. What is the magic feature of SYK? Is no locality, perhaps? Is the presence of interaction, perhaps? Is chaoticity? And the final answer, which is still a little bit, explained at the numerical level, but is still a little bit under investigation at the formal level, is that in order to reach such a nice result, you need chaoticity, and in particular, you need, as I said, high level of spectral rigidity, and to reach that high levels of spectral rigidity, non-locality is a crucial ingredient. So essentially, what I'm gonna say is that interactions by themselves are not really relevant. What play a great role is chaoticity and non-locality together to build up a very highly chaotic Hamiltonian like the SYK. But today, if you want, for pedagogical purpose, I want to give you a slightly different derivation of this result. So I want to show you a slightly different way to understand why SYK performs so well. I want to move to understand a little bit the microscopic origin of the fluctuations. So why, first of all, why fluctuations are there? And once we understand why fluctuations are there, it will be relatively easier to understand how we can kill the fluctuations. So first of all, of course, the fluctuations, the energy fluctuations, are caused by transitions in the probability amplitudes. What I mean is the following. We have our psi tau, and we can define these coefficients, CKI, which are where KI, the cat's KI, are just the eigenstates of H naught. And here I'm putting two indices because K is are our energy levels, and I is an internal index that keep track of the degeneracies. I mean, remember, our H naught is just, an Hamiltonian with all the spins, I mean, essentially, it's just, a constant magnetic field Hamiltonian. So it has many levels, and these levels are highly degenerate. So this I keep track of the degeneracies. And of course, heuristically, you can understand that a fluctuations will be more or less, in the sense this is a rough estimation, but it works a little bit, will be more or less proportional to the bandwidth of H naught and proportional to the square of CKI. So the idea is that we do a transition from CKI to some other state, and we want to understand how strong is the energy fluctuations. So this should be proportional to the square of CKI, which tells me the probability that I move when I do this transition, times the bandwidth of H naught, which tell me how far in energy I move. And so, of course, as I said, the bandwidth of H naught scale with L. So essentially this energy fluctuations goes more or less like a CKI square times L. As I said, this is just, let's say, a bound, an upper bound. Typically the fluctuations are smaller than that, but it's still a decent, it's not that loose, let's say. It's a bit loose as a bound, but it's not that loose. So it's still good to make from some predictions. So based on this intuition, we now want to focus a little bit on the conditions to have larger fluctuations. So first of all, in order to do an energy fluctuations, it's important that we fluctuate, we do a transition between two eigenstates which have the very different energies. And this is trivial indeed. Suppose that we do a transition involving two levels, which are degenerate, the energy doesn't change. So this is the part which is trivial. Moreover, and this is the part that it's a little bit less trivial to understand the consequences, in order to have large fluctuations, it's important that the probability amplitudes of the states involved in the transition are large, because essentially we said that delta E is controlled by CKI square. So if CKI square is small, the fluctuations will be small. Let's be more precise about this last point. So we recognize that in our system, in our problem, we have two relevant quantities. One is the number of particles, L, and the other is the Hilbert space dimension, which is D, and it is 2 to the L. Since this is a many-body system, these two numbers are very, very different from each other. Good. So given these two relevant quantities, we can understand that there are essentially two regimes in our problem. There is a localized regime in which CKI are more or less of order 1 over square root of L, and so most of them are zero and just few are populated with something that goes like 1 over square root of L. And if I replace, if I put this value into here, I get the fluctuations which is of order 1. So they are very large fluctuations. Remember, this is an upper bound, and we will see that in the localized regime, the true fluctuations will be smaller than of order 1, but still will be pretty large. So the localized regime is the regime in which just few eigenstates of H naught are populated, and so their probability amplitudes are large and they are associated with large fluctuations. Instead, there is the regime in which I call the spread regime, in which most of the CKI are occupied, and so their value must be of order 1 over square root of D. And when we put this guy into here, we see that there is an exponentially suppressed fluctuation, because we get something like 2 to the minus L times L, so something rather small. So essentially we recognize, and I will give you some, let's say, numerical evidence in a moment, that we expect that the fluctuations will be controlled by the occupation of the eigenstates of H naught in psi tau. And to quantify the degree of localization, so to quantify if I am in this regime, I can define this guy, which is sigma k, which is essentially the standard deviation over I of CKI. So forget about the formula. The only relevant point to keep in mind is that essentially I measure for a given energy level k, if the various CKI that correspond to that k are similar or different. If they are very different, I'm in the localized regime. So just a few CKI are populated and quite large. If they are very similar, and so the standard deviation is small, that means that I'm in the spread regime, and so the single CKI will be of this regime. So now we want to test our understanding. We want to test if it's true that large values of sigma k, which means being in the localized regime, is associated with larger fluctuations, and being in the spread regime is associated with small fluctuations. So these are the plots. So here in this plot, I'm doing again a numerical check, and I'm doing for the many body localized phase. And here I have the charging protocol, so E of tau with our nice and large fluctuations, and then small fluctuations in this regime and an intermediate regime. And here I plot as a function of time the values in different colors of sigma k that I defined before. And sigma k large correspond to colors around yellow. Sigma k small correspond to colors around blue. So we see that for each fluctuations, we get some spots of yellow, or let's say red colors. So this is in agreement with our understanding that at early time, we have a large value of sigma k and they are associated with large fluctuations. If we go to late time, we see that the color becomes blue, which means that we have reached a situation in which all the sigma k are small and the fluctuations are again small. So this is, and okay, let me show as a comparison the case of SYK. We see that no matter if we are at early time or late time, all the fluctuations are small. And at the same time, sigma k is always small, which means that essentially there are no few eigenstates which are populated. Essentially, the full Hilbert space is populated in an homogeneous way such that we can have small fluctuations. Now, this is a stronger indication, but still I have some missing point that I want to explore a bit better, but this is a strong indication that it is related with the physics of thermalization, and essentially the fact that SYK is very fast in thermalizing is the responsible for this nice performance. And we also showed numerically that this can be, how can I say, put in relation with the quantum chaos and with random matrix theory, as I said, and in particular with spectral rigidity. But a full understanding, a full formal understanding of this connection is still under under construction. We're still investigating it. Now, before changing a little bit the topic, I want to say a few words about the scaling of the fluctuations. So can we understand how strong and how, so here I told you that in this case, the fluctuations should be of order one of less or less. And here they should be exponentially suppressed in L. I wanted to test this hypothesis. So I define this quantity, you can forget it, is simply a measure of how strong are the fluctuations. And I compare the curves for the many body localized phase and for the SYK case. And the result is tantalizing because we see that in the many body localized phase at early times, which we are in the localized regime, we have that our sigma L, you know, theoretically, my bound was saying they should be of order one, but as I said, that bound can be pretty loose, and it is loose, because indeed the true fluctuations fit pretty well with the one over square root of L fitting. So they are suppressed, but just by one over square root of L. So if you want, they are suppressed in terms as a function of the length of the Hilbert of the spin chain, while at late time, when we reach the spread regime, the suppression is exponential in L, which means they are suppressed in terms of the dimension of the Hilbert space. So if you want, the many body localized regime is really funny from this point of view, because depending on the time, on the time scale, you have two different ways of suppressing the fluctuation. One is through the length of the spin chain, the other is through the dimension of the Hilbert space, while as expected, in SYK, both the late time fluctuations and the early time fluctuations are both truncated by an exponential in L, because that means that we are in the spread regime from the very beginning. And so we see two completely different qualitative scaling between the localized and the spread regime. And we conjecture and we have evidences that this could be an interesting new observable to detect thermalization and chaos. So essentially, I'm trying to sell this idea, but I still have to work it a little bit, that the strength of the fluctuations can be a pretty, let's say, sensitive observable to detect if your initial Hamiltonian, if your H1, your quench Hamiltonian is chaotic or not. If it's not chaotic, you will see a suppression of the fluctuations, which is truncated by one over square root of L. If it's not, it will be truncated by some exponential in the chaotic case. Notice that coming back to Sayantan's question before, the outcome is that whenever you are in the chaotic regime, the suppression will be exponential, but this exponential suppression is much more efficient depending on the level, depending on the spectral rigidity. So if you just have level repulsion, the curve fit with an exponential, but this exponential is not as efficient as in SYK. So if you want, quantum chaos is necessary in order to have an exponential. And how fast is the decay of this exponential is controlled by the spectral rigidity. So this is the main lesson that we learn from this experiment. And essentially this end up the first part of the talk in which we focused on the energy stored in the battery and the time fluctuations. And we learned that SYK is a good candidate because it is highly chaotic, and so it can reach very fast a spread regime in which the fluctuations are suppressed. Questions before changing a little bit the topic? Okay, so let's change, let's switch the gears and let's go to another topic, which is the quantum charging supremacy. So now we, which a term that has been promoted probably by Julia Farré and collaborators, but probably was already there before. Anyway, we now focus on another figure of merit, which is the average charging power. So not only we ask how to reach a high level of energies stored in our battery, but we also ask how fast we can be in putting energy in the battery. So this is the power that we want to investigate. I mean, how fast we are in storing the energy. Out of this quantity, which we learned just from physics one when we were in the bachelor, which the power is just E divided by tau, we can define what I call the optimal charging time, which is the time, tau star, at which the charging power is maximum, simply. Now, suppose that we have a battery, like in our case, made of L cells. So our H naught is the sum from 1 to L of Hi, which is our case, actually. Now, there is this, this, let me call it theorem, that any classical device, so any classical battery, can have at most a linear scaling. So P of tau star can scale at most linearly with L. So from this came out the idea of calling quantum charging supremacy. So the idea is that can we use some quantum effects, some intrinsically quantum effects, to trigger some superlinear scaling? So can we use quantum mechanics in order to get an optimal charging power P of tau star, which scale like L one plus alpha with alpha greater than zero? This is something that cannot be achieved via a classical device. And notice that a consequence of that, suppose that we reach this situation, we will have here L one plus alpha. Here, the energy stored in the battery scale linearly with alpha, linearly with L. So that means that the charging time is decreasing with L. So essentially, it's telling us that if we have more cells, we become faster in charge. So we could even hope that in the thermodynamic limit, our charging become, say, instantaneous, because, I mean, the time decreases with alpha. Of course, I mean,
so this is an idea. This alpha can be only integer, or it can
no, be can be whatever. Number can also. Be whatever. Can be whatever. Yeah, can be whatever. Yeah, and whatever values greater than zero can be already, let's say, dubbed as a quantum supremacy, in the sense that you have a scaling which is better than just linear. But of course, I mean, larger is better. But yeah, alpha can be whatever. Okay, so how to study this problem? Well, to make a long story short, Julia Farré collaborators in this paper, they found that the charging power can be bounded by this quantity in which these two quantities are essentially the variances of H naught and H1 evaluated at time t over our evolved state. So they bound the power.
I just want to point one thing. I have found one, because I was looking in one literature, something, is this related to something called quantum speed limit?
It is. It is.
Yeah.
What you call quantum speed limit is this guy.
Yes, yes, yes.
Is this guy. On the other hand, we will focus mostly on this guy. Essentially, okay. the reason is because as I said, making a long story short, the quantum, getting a nonlinear scaling from this term can be reached in a quite trivial way. Let's say, suppose that I rescale my H1 by something that scales with L, I can easily, how can I say, tune this guy to be scale as I like. So let's say that this is a pretty trivial way to increase the power. Instead, this guy delta tau H naught zero that in the particular case take this form, HI HJ evaluated over time minus HI over time HJ over time. This is something that you cannot, is completely unaffected by rescaling of H1, and it is something that you cannot simply fine tune by playing with parameters. I mean, it's something that it is intrinsically quantum. And so, let's say an honest, a true quantum charging supremacy can be reached if you can find the maximum over time of this guy as a function of L scale faster than linearly in L. Notice that, okay, this term in principle has the property that can scale even quadratically, because here I'm summing over I different than J, so I have L squared terms. However, notice that, for example, if your state zero is a product state, this guy simply vanish. So in order to don't vanish, you need entanglement. So that's why this is really a smoking gun of a quantum effect, because without entanglement, you cannot get anything interesting out of that. So this is why we focus on this term. Good. Okay, so let's test the behavior of two SYK batteries, which look pretty similar. And this will bring us to a puzzle, and the solution of the puzzle will tell us something about the dynamics of operator and something about this guy. So let's consider these two batteries in which the quench Hamiltonian is always the same, is our SYK Hamiltonian. However, the two H, we consider two slightly different H naught, H zero. One has the magnetic field, as we did before, aligned along the Z axis. The other has the magnetic field aligned along the X axis. Now, you may ask why we did this seemingly stupid experiment. I mean, in principle, you say, come on, you're doing almost nothing. You are just rotating a magnetic field. For sure, the performance will be the same. Nevertheless, we did this experiment, and this was the result. The performance as a function of L of our quantifier was dramatically different as a function of L. In the case of the X model, which means in the case in which H is aligned along the X axis, the power scale like L square. So it's telling us that this is showing quantum supremacy. In the case of the Z model, in which we just do a simple rotation, the power is scaling linearly. So this was both good and bad. In some sense, we were happy because this was a first example of quantum supremacy using SYK, so we were happy. On the other hand, we were really, how can I say, confused by this. How is it possible that a simple rotation is so crucial in changing so dramatically the behavior? So we spent some time in understanding the puzzle. And actually the solution of the puzzle at the end tell us something about the dynamics of operators in hyperspace and how this may have or may not have a role. Okay, so let's try to solve the puzzle, and to do that, let's focus on the single summons. So remember, this is the quantity that we want to compute, in which H, I, X, or Z are our sigma I, X, or sigma I, Z, and so on. And okay, it is, first of all, it is immediate to see that both this gentleman and this gentleman, all of them, as a function of time, goes in opportune units that I don't want to enter, goes from 1 to 0 with time. So they are both decreasing functions that go from 1 to 0 with time. So we understand that in order to maximize this guy, we need that the product of these two decay much faster than this guy, because if they decay with similar rate, this will be simply zero. I mean, it starts from zero because both are one, so it starts from zero. And in order to have at a certain time this quantity large, you need that at a certain time this guy is already almost zero, while this guy is still significantly different from zero. So this is the essence of the charging supremacy. Good. So to understand how is it possible that these guys decay much faster than these, only in the X model and not in the Z model, it's convenient to go to an Heisenberg picture and to study the operator dynamics of the decay of this guy. So as I said, at equal to zero, H, I, X, Z are both equal to one. So they start from one. Both these, I'm saying this for this guy, but the same story apply also for this guy, at least qualitatively. Now, when I go to the Heisenberg picture, in at equal to zero, my H, I, X, Z at the time T can be written in this way. We have a certain alpha, which is smaller than one, which is still in the original operator, H, I, X, Z. But then by time evolution in Heisenberg picture, I start to create what I call contamination terms. So terms which are different and orthogonal to H, I, X, Z, and that on average give zero contribution to the time evolution. So the neat effect is that this contamination term bring my expectation value from one to alpha, which is smaller than one, and so make the reduction. So essentially we learn that the speed of the decay of these guys, or saying this guy, is controlled by how fast I create these contamination terms. So now the question is, how and why the X model is faster in creating the contamination terms than the Z model? The claim that I'm gonna do, and I will try to convince you, is that the speed of creating the contamination terms is controlled by the operator size. And the claim is that if my operators have larger sizes, they are faster in creating contamination terms, and this creates a faster decay. So let's define what I mean by operator size, and that's it. That's it. And then let's go to the particular case. So operator size, I say that a certain operator OK has size K if it can be written exactly as a product of kappa fundamental operators. So I need to define what I mean by fundamental operators. And here I'm a bit sloppy in the sense that I don't have my definition is still case by case. I don't have a general understanding of this point, but it works. So what I call fundamental operators are the operators which are easiest to describe the dynamics. And in this particular problem, it is highly convenient to take as a fundamental operators, not the Pauli operators, but take the gamma I, the Majorana operators. Now, if I do this choice, I realize that once I consider as fundamental operators the gamma I, the Pauli becomes composite operators. And in particular, so I can ask the sites of sigma IZ, sigma IZ, sigma JZ, sigma IX, sigma IX, sigma JX. In particular, I see this funny feature that both sigma IZ and sigma IZ, sigma JZ have fixed sites, and in particular sigma iz is of size 2, which means that can be written as the product of two gammas, and this gentleman can be written as the product of four gammas. The situation is different for the X model. To build sigma ix, I need to multiply 2i minus 1 gammas, and to build this guy, I need to multiply 2 times j minus I gamma operators. So in particular, in the X model, I have the sites of my operators, which enter here, have different sizes depending on I, while instead in the Z case, they have all the same size. Good. Now we are ready to explain the charging supremacy. Let's go back to our beloved expression. Let's keep our table, which tells us the sizes, and let's start with the Z model. Here we have an operator of size 4, minus the product of two operator of size 2. Now, the operator of size 4 decay faster than the size 2 operator, However, the product of two sites two operator decays slightly faster than a sites four operator. So there is a small difference between the decay of these two guys. And so their difference always remains small. And so this quantity doesn't grow. The situation is completely different for the X model because I have varying sites. And in particular, the sites is take is this form. This guy is an operator of sites 2j minus I, while these two guys have sizes 2i minus 1, 2j minus 1. In particular, if I take I similar to j and similar to L divided by 2, so around the center of the spin chain, this is a small operator because j minus I, they are similar. So this is an operator of sites 2 or something like that. On the other hand, these two operators both become operator of sites L. So they are very large. So I have a parametric difference between operators which are slow, which are small and so slow in decaying, and operators which are large and so fast in decaying. So the difference between these two give a large difference in this guy and so make possible to get the charging supremacy for the X model. So we learn that the charging supremacy of the X model is nothing but the consequence of operator sites and the motion, let's say, of the dynamics of the operators induced by the quench in the operator space. So I think I can more or less conclude the talk and then maybe we can chat a little bit. So let me conclude. As I said, we showed that we can introduce quantum battery is based on a double sudden quench. And I tried to convince you, and hopefully I did, that the SYK batteries are nice, both because they reduce the time fluctuations. And we somehow understood that this reduction was due to the fast thermalizing properties of SYK, and also can reach the charging supremacy, which is controlled. The possibility to have charging supremacy is controlled by an interplay between the presence of interactions and the notion of operator sites. And something that I'm currently doing, as I mentioned, it is to study the relationship between the fluctuations and quantum chaos. And something which is actually pretty soon, we should be able to finish pretty soon, is to develop a full theory of the charging supremacy. So to develop, let's say, necessary and sufficient conditions, so let's say arguments to understand from first principle if a given quantum battery has the chance to be supreme or not, so beyond just this example of SYK. So I think more or less I can conclude here, and I thank you very much for the attention and for the questions.
Thank you, Dario, for this nice talk. And if there is any question from the other guy who is attending, please ask. Otherwise, before that, I would request all of you means one guy, to give a clap for him for giving such a nice talk. And now you can ask.
Yeah, thank you for the talk. I mean, like you add more spins and then you reduce the fluctuation. That's how the battery is charged more effectively. Yeah, that's what you say, right?
No, you need to ask again. Hello? Sorry.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah. Can you ask again? Sorry, I didn't get.
Oh, sorry. sorry, my son is.
I understand the situation.
sorry, my son is with me, so he's.
Absolutely fine.
He woke up. Yeah. Okay, so when you add more coupling, then you kind of get into more of the situations, right? But it's the other way around, right?
The other way around. I mean, when you get more and more interactions, and in particular when you reach a chaotic situation, the fluctuations are highly reduced. okay. essentially the bottom, I mean, the reason being that you become much more efficient in thermalizing, and so in spreading your state to occupy the full Lieber space, and that reduced dramatically the fluctuations. I mean, the physical picture is very clear. It would be nice to get some more, let's say, formal understanding, maybe, for example, a more formal understanding of the relationship with quantum chaos. But yes, the picture is pretty clear that faster you are in occupying the full Lieber space, and better it is.
Yeah, it's kind of counterintuitive. So that's why I was, it was looking a little weird for me. And then, and also you mentioned about the localization in the earlier section. Yeah. So.
So essentially, yes. I mean, I'm using localized, let's say, in a quite loose way, but I'm meaning that essentially our evolved state, Psi Tau, is localized to just a few of the eigenstates of H naught. This is what I mean. I mean, if Psi Tau doesn't cover the full Hilbert space, you get fluctuations, essentially.
Okay. Uh-huh.
Unless
so,
maybe go please.
Yeah, so I mean, like, when you have larger systems, let's say even this you mentioned, like, so when you have larger system, then you get a small localization, is it? So small CKA.
You get exactly, and indeed this is intuitively and it is correct, because even in the localized regime, the fluctuations, sorry, I don't see my mouse anymore. Okay, he's here. The fluctuations are still reduced, but they are reduced just by a factor of L. So if you want, it's like to say that the system in the localized regime don't see the full Hilbert space, just see the dimension of the spin chain. Okay. Instead, when you go to the spread regime, the system is able to see the full spin chain, the full Hilbert space, if you want. So you get a truncation, you get truncated by an exponential in L.
Okay. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Thanks a lot. Yeah, that's it. I don't have much questions anyway. But the talk was very beautiful, actually. Thanks. I like it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I will not ask question. I will ask maybe later, because I will see the talk more and I will ask. I have already asked too many questions.
No, they were welcomed. Yeah.
And yeah, like, I will get in touch with you, and this talk will be posted in YouTube. And so very nice. And take care, stay safe. And enjoy with your family and with the new member of your family.
Exactly.
Yes.
Exactly. That's why I said how should I pronounce it? Nagesvaran. That I totally understand your situation, because I got a stone in the last few weeks, so I totally understand your situation.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, thank you very much.
Thanks a lot. Yeah, bye-bye.
Yeah.
Bye.
Bye.